Hey everyone, this is Bart Koppers in the forest. Let me ask you a question. Are you a member of my Patreon yet? No? Oh my god. Then you are missing out. Because every month I'm going to collect questions from people on my crowdfunding platform Patreon and answer them in a monthly FHQ video. Yeah, that's right, every month. For as little as $1 you can join and ask me questions which I will answer live in this FHQ series every month. Today we are in the forest in a nice place where I like to relax, and I'm going to answer the questions I collected for this month on Patreon. Keep in mind, I am and have been a professional consultant for butterfly farms who pay me for my advice. So this is a pretty cheap way for me to get me to answer questions for you in regards to butterflies and moths. Because I've actually been employed to give people advice. So here you can get my professional advice through Patreon. The first question is by Darren D. Thank you very much for being my patron, Darren. It's people who like you who support my channel and actively keep it going as a demonetized content creator. Darren asked me, is purchasing butterfly and moth specimens ethical? A very interesting question. Is it one way to support the farm breeding species? I am recently interested in using them in artwork, but since I don't know if they just kill them for products or that they die naturally got me anxious. I don't want to do harm. Also, what is the other way to support the butterfly and moth breeders? Thank you. I'm going to be blunt with you. If you go to a museum shop and you see these perfect butterflies in frames and people claim that these have died naturally, you got scammed. I breed thousands of butterflies and moths, and I can assure you, in captivity they rarely die in perfect condition. While it happens, it is generally so rare, it is not possible to film whole web shops with them, whole museum stores who sell hundreds of these framed butterflies and moths. If you let them live their natural lifespan, most of the time they are going to get imperfections because their wings degrade over time. The more they fly, their colors will also fade. The fresh, good-looking butterflies you see in frames, I guarantee you, 99.9% of the time, were killed. They were killed when they came from the pupa, when they were still fresh, euthanized and taxidermied to sell. This brings us to the next question. Is it unethical to kill a butterfly or moth in order to conserve it for a collection? Surprisingly, my opinion is no. I don't really care about the individual lives of butterflies and moths, and I think there is nothing wrong with killing one. Let that sink in, that's actually my opinion. But I think that what is wrong is lying. If you are honest about it, like, yes, I farm butterflies and I kill the butterflies so I can sell them to customers who collect them, I don't see anything wrong with it. But when you lie about it, when you say, oh, the butterflies died naturally, don't worry, I didn't kill them, that's unethical because you are lying. Some people do have a problem with killing, and I disagree with that, but I think these people are entitled to their opinion, right? Like, if you are a vegetarian, it's completely fine. You are entitled to think killing animals is wrong, and you are entitled to choose your own food in the supermarket and know, ha, this food has no meat, for this food no animals were harmed, right? So lying about this is unethical, and it takes away the consumer's choice. You're basically scamming somebody into buying something they would normally not buy if they have an issue with killing. That being said, if it's harmful to kill butterflies and moths just to sell them as decoration, it depends on the species and it depends on how they are collected. Generally speaking, it is actually not a harmful practice to kill butterflies and moths, even in the wild. That's because they reproduce so insanely fast, Sometimes butterflies can lay hundreds and hundreds of eggs. So, and they have really high mortality rates in the wild. Sometimes less than 10% of all the eggs a butterfly lays will actually make it to butterflies, and 90% will die, will get eaten by birds, by predators, by viruses, by parasites, diseases, fungi. So it's actually very hard to capture and kill so many butterflies that it becomes unethical. So my take on the situation is actually that it is not as harmful as people make it out to be. However, there are exceptions. In some cases, there can be butterflies who are very rare and threatened species. Some species are endemic to islands. Think of some really rare butterflies of the genus Ornithoptera, for example. They have low population densities because the butterfly have a high biomass. Also sensitive to environmental destruction. If you go and kill hundreds of them senselessly, it could potentially make a harmful impact. But the problem is as follows. The reason butterflies and moths are declining worldwide on a massive scale is not because they are being collected or poached. And in fact, we are driving many, many species to extinction. But the way we are doing it is basically with agriculture. We are deforesting massive amounts of habitat, you know, of suitable terrain for insects. We are burning it down, we are slashing it, we are turning it into pastures. We are turning it into fields of soybean and rice, fields where we farm cattle. And this is one of the most harmful practices possible that drives many insects extinct. Another thing that humans do is we use pesticides on a massive scale. Like the global amount of pesticide we use in tropical and developing countries is often completely unregulated. In the West, it is a little bit more regulated. But the reason that pollinators and bees are dying out is still because we use a lot of neonicotinoids, which are very harmful pesticides. In ridiculous amounts, insects don't stand a chance of surviving in environments regulated by humans because we douse everything in insane amount of pesticides that kill all the animals. And I think it's pretty unfair to make a big deal out of collecting and killing individual butterflies and say, "Wah! You are the reason butterflies are going extinct because you're killing them." Yeah, that's a bit short-sighted, because if you open your eyes, look at the big picture, it's actually not the collectors that are driving them extinct. It's the big companies. It is big agriculture. It is meat consumption. It is soybean production. By the way, soybean is often farmed to feed cows, so it really is meat. Meat is a major player. Pesticides are a major player, but also some crops, some minor crops like orchards of, like fruit trees, stuff like that, rice fields, whatever it is people produce locally. Generally, people slash and burn down the forest. And the best way to drive a species to extinction is to destroy its home. A healthy population of animals can be hunted and collected sustainably, you know. It's like hunting deer. If you don't hunt and kill more deer than there are born every year, you're not endangering the species. But that is based on the premise the population is healthy. If we slash down the forest and the deers don't have anywhere to live, and they struggle to survive, and then you start hunting them, then you are contributing to their decline. So it really depends on the circumstances. I am not against collecting butterflies from the wild. I think it's harmless in most cases, but we should keep our hands off rare and threatened species. There's actually a lot of common species which you can collect millions and millions of, and it would not make a single difference to their populations. But you have to make sure that they are legally obtained, not protected species, but also not really rare or endemic species that are harvested in massive amounts. If the butterflies are farmed in captivity, I don't see the problem. Lots of people eat meat, they will enjoy a delicious juicy steak or a hamburger. But when they see a butterfly in a frame, it's, "Oh no, how can you kill the butterfly? Where?" It's a bit hypocritical. In most cases, not all cases, but in most cases, these butterflies are farmed. There's butterfly farms breeding millions of these butterflies, killing them and exporting them. There's also a tiny amount of people, yeah, collecting them from the wild. It is ethically a little bit more questionable, I agree. Especially if you're just killing and killing and killing just to make money. It feels a bit senseless. But I also think it doesn't receive the massive backlash it gets right now. Because it's really not that big of a deal. The massive scale destruction that our society is wreaking, it's basically wreaking havoc on the populations of wild insects across the globe and driving them extinct because we are literally slashing and burning the places where they survive. As opposed to people collecting handfuls of butterflies that replenish themselves in the wild pretty fast in most cases. So the scrutiny is a little bit unfair. That being said, if you ethically want to buy collected butterflies, make sure you do it from a reputable breeder. I think it's better to get butterflies from captivity than one taken from the wild, you know. If you take something from the wild, you're taking it out of the population. It's better if they were farmed for that purpose because it's a more sustainable thing. Personally, I am not a big fan in general of butterflies as art deco, just as decoration in your room. I support people collecting butterflies and moths in a scientific way. It allows us to learn about them. But collecting them just for decoration because it looks pretty in a frame seems a bit superficial and shallow to me. Sorry if that sounds harsh. Then again, when I see people do it, I am not morally outraged. I think it's a way to get people invested in the beauty of insect. And I think small-scale collecting and killing butterflies just to prepare them in a beautiful way is actually not that bad. It gets more backlash than it deserves. Just because butterflies are seen as beautiful and innocent and touching them is a no-no, at the same time the products you eat that you consume are contributing to their destruction much more than one in a tiny little frame. That being said, if you see something has naturally died, most of the cases you're being lied to. If you're a vegetarian, if you have an issue with killing animals, I believe you deserve to have a honest opinion from a seller. I wouldn't sell steak to vegetarians claiming that no animals were harmed to produce steak. No animals were harmed to produce this leather. That's bullshit, that's scamming, that's a lie, and sadly it often happens. Last but least, if you want to support butterfly and moth breeders, I am here. I work in the industry. I'm 100% crowdfunded. And in fact, you are already a member of my Patreon. The donation money that you are sending me is being used to breed more butterflies and moths in a sustainable way and make videos about them to educate people about their conservation and biology on YouTube. Would I go as far as to say that if you want to support the conservation of butterflies and moths, you should support me, Bart Koppens? Actually, yes! I'm closely tied to multiple butterfly farms and moth farms. I give them advice. I help run their breeding programs. I'm also independent. I'm a researcher. I'm an entomologist. I work in collections. I label species. I identify them. I document them on YouTube. There's thousands of people watching my YouTube and getting new respect for these animals in a way that is otherwise impossible through social media. I think it's a pretty good deal to support me, even if I say so myself. I'm one of the few people who is doing this independently. I don't know any other YouTubers as big as me who are into butterfly and moth conservation or trying to promote their conservation, really. I'm really one of the few and who actually have experience to back it up. And you're already part of my Patreon, for which I thank you. So you've already done your part. Jade asked me, for a beginner looking to get into keeping mainly Saturnidae, what are the staple plants you'd recommend for acquiring the garden to nurture? I see Ligustrum, Fages, which is beech, Crataegus, which is hawthorn, Rubus, which is bramble, Prunus, which is cherry, Acer, which is maple, and Salix, which is willow, are often mentioned. Are there others you found to be a sturdy contender as a food source for multiple silk moth species? Well, it sounds like you have the basis down. The plants you mentioned are excellent. If I do have a few suggestions for you. A really important one missing on your list is Quercus or oak tree. Oak tree is one of the most widely eaten food plants by many Saturnidae. I've raised species from South America, species from Africa, from tropical Asia, all on oak tree. It's crazy how many species will enjoy eating oak tree. For me, having oak tree around me is essential for so many species. It's a beautiful and beneficial plant, and there's hundreds of Saturnids that will eat it. Another one I found to be missing on your list is sweet gum or liquid amber. Now, in my experience, sweet gum is a plant that Palearctic species of Saturnids will enjoy, which is species from Europe and North America. But also many species from temperate and even tropical Asia will love eating it. Moon moths really, really love sweet gum or liquid amber in general. I think I raised over 10 species of moon moth exclusively on sweet gum. I think Atlas moth will love sweet gum. Rotstielia moth will love sweet gum. A lot of Automeris species will love sweet gum. Samia species. Chronimbrasia species will love sweet gum. Basically, sweet gum is a really beneficial plant for a lot of variety of Saturnids. Another plant I really recommend having is Robinia. I don't know the English name of Robinia. I think it's something like... Is it honey locust? No, maybe not. Or is it? Anyway, Robinia pseudo-acacia is an amazing plant. Especially Automeris species love it. Automeris is crazy about Robinia. A lot of species grow perfectly on it. On top of that, there's a lot of Saturnids who specialize in eating Fabaceae, which is the pea family. A lot of African Saturnids almost exclusively eat Robinia. Species like Aurifilias, or many Nudaurelia, or well, what else is there? I mentioned Automeris, but also Cerato Campinae. Many of them specialize in eating stuff related to honey locusts and, I could be wrong, I should say Robinia. If you have that plant, it enables you to breed dozens of species. It's a really good plant. Another recommendation that I have is eucalyptus. If you live in a temperate climate, I recommend getting Eucalyptus gunnii. I think it's called blue gum. There's many Saturnids who love eucalyptus, including moon moths. Moon moths are crazy about eucalyptus in general. There's a lot of species you can raise on it. Also species from Papua, Australia, Australasia will generally love munching on eucalyptus. I think if you have eucalyptus, you can also breed stuff like cricula, also stuff like leopard moths, but they're not Saturnids. Eucalyptus gunnii is a super good plant to have. There's even Saturnids that mainly use eucalyptus as their house plant, so such as Ophidiptera. Pretty cool moth species. I have yet to do a life cycle on them, because I don't have eucalyptus yet. I should buy some with the crowdfunding, because it will allow me to breed even more species. Another recommendation that is missing from your list is pinus or pine tree. Now, there's actually not that many Saturnids who eat pine tree. But the ones that do are often specialists in eating pine tree. And I'm talking about species like the Spanish moon moth, Geelcia isabella. Most people know this. Or what about the Chinese moon moth, or Actios dubernardi? What about the pine devil, Citeronia sepulcralis? Or Copaxis sidipe, a species that I've already raised in the past. There's a small amount of Saturnids who love pine tree. But the problem is most of them don't really eat anything else. A lot of species that eat pine trees tend to be specialists on pine tree. And if you don't have it, you cannot raise them. There's also really rare ones like Actios chapai. I don't know if they're ever going to return to the hobby. They were once common in the hobby. That was like 2007. Since then, I've never seen them for sale again. I'd love to do a life cycle on that one. There's many more Saturnids too who specialize on pine tree. So you want to be able to plant some if you really want to be a Saturnid specialist. Nostalgia Carl asked me, what are your thoughts on the white witch moth or Tisania agrippina? I think it's a fascinating species. I would love to see it in the wild. It's my dream. But in the Netherlands, it's impossible. So for me to do that, I must really travel. Sadly, it's impossible to buy their pupa online, because their life cycle is still unrecorded to science, unfortunately. So science does not know what host plant they have, and the life cycle is still unknown. It's a mystery. So therefore, it's impossible to order eggs or caterpillars or cocoons of them so I can show them to you. This is one species, the biggest moth species in the world. If I want to show it to you, I must travel. But I cannot spoil all my plans for next year yet. But there is a very large chance that I may be able to travel to a place where these moths are in the wild. Are you getting excited? I hope you are getting excited, because I have big plans for this channel next year. Not going to spoil too much yet. But at some point in the pipeline, I do plan to do a big travel. But I have not decided exactly where yet. I'm still keeping it a bit secret. My preference would be South America somewhere. But due to COVID, it is hard. Maybe plan B could be parts of Africa, or maybe even like Florida, parts of the United States. I could go to Papua maybe, Brazil. I was really hoping to go to French Guiana. It's actually my preferred country, but the border is closed. I hope the situation changes. Otherwise, I will have to think about something else maybe. But this is just a spoiler for the future, okay? Don't pin it on me. This could take a lot of time to plan all of this and figure it out. I also need a lot of support from my viewers like you who are helping me do spectacular stuff. I would love to see it, but it's still a bit of an enigma. I would love to have it on my channel, and that's all I can say about it, because so little is known about the insect. I can show you though that one person has in fact found a caterpillar recently before it pupated. Here I can show you a picture. This is not my picture, okay? I have to give credit to the original photographer of this picture who put it on Instagram. But here you have it. The caterpillar of the white witch was recently discovered for the first time. Unfortunately, it was pre-pupal and not sitting on its host plant. So the host plant is still a mystery after all these years. Maybe I could find out if I had enough funding. I have the brains, I have the talent, but I don't have the money to do those crazy things. Not yet. Maybe I can if we grow this channel and we can really help the conservation of these animals. Last but not least, Sylvain Carbonell asked me, what are your thoughts on crossing butterfly or moth species? Have you experimented it? If yes, what kind of species? Thank you. It's a funny story. A lot of people on this channel often ask me to make hybrids. I am not ethically against making hybrids. I think hybrids can be fascinating. In biology, there is something known as species barriers. And the way to one ancestor species evolutionary diverges into two or multiple species also comes down to the fact that two populations of the same species eventually get isolated genetically. And from an evolutionary point of view, the moment that two populations are isolated and do not produce fertile offspring and exchange genes, is the moment that they can start to diverge due to different environmental pressures, or basically also different distributions of genetic traits which randomly flow in these populations on top of the different selective pressures. So to figure out why the two species that are closely related evolve or split into two different species, we can look at the things that separate them. And one of the things that separates them sometimes is geographical barriers. Sometimes if there is a mountain range separating two populations of the same species, on both sides of the mountains over time they will adopt a different appearance. This could be due to different predators or a slightly different climate, or simply random gene flow on both sides of the population slowly but steadily altering them over time. And when you take these two populations and you artificially cross them in captivity and they produce fertile offspring, it can actually be an indicator that perhaps they are very closely related, and the fact that they are isolated The fact that they are genetically isolated is not due to the fact they are genetically incompatible or physically incompatible, but simply because of a geographical barrier that's separating them, not so much as biology preventing them from interbreeding. But sometimes it can be more complicated. Moth species can have pheromones that are unique to their own species, and the males of one species will only respond to the pheromone of the female of their respective species and not another species. But when paired in captivity in artificial conditions, they will produce offspring, sometimes even fertile offspring. In that case, we can conclude the reason these species evolutionarily diverged is because different selective pressures and adaptations in their unique pheromone markers. But sometimes hybridization will fail because their genitals, for example, are incompatible. The genitals of butterflies and moths are often like a lock and a key-like mechanism. They have to perfectly fit together, and if they don't, you can say, well, these two are different species because their genitals have a different morphology and do not match up and are unable to create fertile offspring, which is strong evidence for the fact that selective pressures, when it comes to like, well, it's almost like an arms race between males and females trying to copulate, changes the morphology of their genitals into isolated populations until they are unable to interbreed. But sometimes you can also see that genetically two very similar populations are unable to form fertile offspring, creating really weird hybrids or freaks. It's also very interesting to see how primitive traits of a relict species can be passed down to a more modern relative of the same group of animals. So hybrids, in my opinion, are incredibly fascinating and incredibly important. I think hybridization should be, in some cases, encouraged as an experiment because it can reveal more about the biology of these insects in general. However, on my channel I have not made a lot of hybrids, and I'm not sure why. I think that I really enjoy studying wild butterflies and moths, like a wild population, the way that they live in the wild. And to me, hybrids feel very artificial. Despite the fact that I recognize that hybridization is important, it's fascinating, it allows us to learn more, it's good experimentation. At the same time, I don't really enjoy doing it myself that much. So the amount of hybrids you'll see on my channel is actually very limited, because I have a wildlife perspective. I look at moths from a wildlife biology perspective and not from a domestic animal perspective. Let's see what weird stuff I can create in captivity by experimenting. No, I like imagining how they live in the wild and thinking about that. That's what fascinates me. And if you have a hybrid, most of the time it doesn't happen in the wild. Most of the hybrids are completely artificial. Not all of them. There are Saturnids that naturally hybridize. Hyalophoras are a good example. But also some species of Saturnia have natural hybrid zones. Despite that fact, I am not a huge fan of making hybrids myself, because there's a lot of stupid hype around it. Like, oh my god, I crossed Arctias dubernardi with Graelsia. It has been done dozens of times, and most of the time people are just interested in the expensive specimens that they create. I mean, to be fair, they look very beautiful, I can see the appeal. But the insane amount of hype around it is stupid. I don't really buy into that. That being said, sometimes I will, if I have spare males and females of a species, I will try to make the hybrid. In my Samia moth cycles episode, you can see me crossing a species of Samia from the Philippines, Luzonica, with a domesticated Samia resini, and the result was very beautiful. The larvae were very big and colorful, and so were the adults. It was really crazy. If you want to see me making an actual hybrid, look for my moth series called web series called Moth Cycles. Look for it on my channel. Find the episode about the Tree of Heaven silk moth, or the Eerie silk moth, Samia resini. And in the end of that episode, you can see me actually creating my own hybrid. It's one of the first times I've done it. Maybe I will try it more often in the future. Who knows? I'm also really preoccupied with documenting the life cycles of normal species as they live in the wild. It's more fascinating to me than an artificial freak I created in captivity. That being said, I am open to the idea. Maybe someday I will decide I'm going to cross two rare species of moon moth and we will see the hybrid. I'm very young, I'm only 28 years old. I can keep doing YouTube for like 30, 40 years as long as the website exists. And as long as people are supporting me, I will continue to do so and we will see crazy content. In 7 years' time, I documented the life history of some incredibly rare butterflies and moths, and I intend to keep going. So if in 7 years I produced 1200 videos, imagine what I can do in the next 7 years with all my experience, only becoming better, only becoming more experienced, only getting more subscribers. This channel is going to go above and beyond. But I cannot do it without your help. And this brings me to the next segment, people. My channel is 100% demonetized by YouTube, unfortunately. What does that mean? Being demonetized means that YouTube does not support my channel. When normal YouTubers upload a video on their channel, and they get a lot of... Damn, I have the hiccups. And they get a lot of views and subscribers, people make money from it. And my big problem is that I don't make any money at all from YouTube. Zero. Because YouTube does not support me and my content. This video, I made $0. If I film the life cycle of a butterfly or a moth, even if it takes a year to produce the freaking video, in some cases it takes me over a year to produce those videos, by the way. All that effort for $0. And that's why the crowdfunding is so important for me. I'm basically constantly begging on the internet because I really need a budget to continue my show. And that's where you, my viewers, come in. And that's why I started doing this monthly FHQ series. It gives people more quality, more value for their donation. You're able to ask me questions in return. And every month I will answer them for you on camera. It allows me to get to know my audience and my sponsors a little bit better. That being said, without your support, I cannot do anything. I have big plans for this channel. I want to travel someday. I want to build a butterfly or moth laboratory someday. Or, I don't know, having my own butterfly greenhouse or my own butterfly garden where we can breed rare butterflies and see them fly and breed. But all of that is not possible without money. I cannot travel the world without money. I cannot breed rare butterflies and moths without money. I can't have the free time to film videos every day, day in and day out, without money. And it's basically the budget I get from my fans by begging on the internet that determines if I can go above and beyond to entertain you. Now, the service I provide is free. It's almost like going to a restaurant and there's a waiter and the waiter will bring you your food. And you know the service is almost free because waiters often get paid terribly. And most of them are dependent on the generosity, on the tips of donations of the patrons who come to the restaurant. Now, tipping is optional, but at the same time, you know, when you go to a restaurant and there's a waiter who gives you your food or your drink, you know that that person is dependent on your tips and donations for the continuation of their service. Because if nobody tipped them, there would be no reason for them to continue doing it. And for me, it's kind of the same. I'm providing a free service to many viewers. None of you are obliged to tip and donate, of course. And not doing so doesn't make you less of a viewer. I understand not everybody can afford it in financially difficult times. But if you are willing and able to do it, then please consider doing so. It will ensure the survival of the service, of the content that you enjoy to see on YouTube. On me educating you about butterflies and moths and showing you their rare life cycles, showing you nature in my country, educating people about insects that get so little attention. If you haven't subscribed to my Patreon yet, today is a very good day to do so because we have a new series, a monthly FHQ series. I'm going to do this every month from now on, answer your personal questions, even if they are weird and silly, I do not care. Second of all, I've been designing merchandise using my own stickers, using my own photographs of my own insects. I designed mugs with butterflies and moths on them. I designed posters with butterflies and moths on them. I designed t-shirts with butterflies and moths on them. I designed printouts with butterflies and moths on them. And those of you who become a member of my Patreon can be eligible for some of these rewards. Now, if you go to my Patreon on patreon.com/BartButterflies, you can see all the reward tiers and all the benefits that they offer. For me, it's really important to offer people quality and value in return for their support. This channel is 100% demonetized. There is no company looking out for me. I don't get any sponsorship from YouTube. I don't get a single cent from YouTube. I don't have any affiliate marketing going on right now. It's just me as a one-man army doing all of this myself, producing thousands of videos that sometimes take over a year to produce, all alone, all by myself. Supporting it is optional, but supporting it is highly recommended if you enjoy it and you see the quality and the value in what I provide to you as a YouTuber. And for that, I thank you. On my Patreon, it's possible to ask me questions for next month, and we will be back with a newer FHQ. Of course, I trust you guys to send me interesting questions. The more interesting the questions are that patrons send to me, the more fun the FHQ is going to be, right? Because cool and difficult questions or interesting questions is what makes the show more interesting. If people ask me questions like, Bart, how big is your peepee? It's not going to be a really cool episode. Although people will be impressed by the huge size of my peepee, of course. But hey, that's beside the point. Hey, this Bart Kopp is out. See you next month. Thank you all for supporting my Patreon. It means the world to me. You are my lifeblood. All the budget I have to make my cool videos comes from you, my patrons. Bye-bye.